Hey, happy Monday, everyone. Hope you got a chance to be a part of our service on Sunday. Kicked off a brand new series talking about the grace of God. On these I stand, and you can't start with theology without starting with God, His goodness, and of course, His grace and power. Today, I want to take you to what I believe to be one of the greatest verses in the Bible on the grace of God. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 17 to 21. Let me read it. We'll make a few observations today. And in some regard, application is going to be mixed in throughout, although I will end with a key one today too. Therefore, whoever is in Christ is a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. All of this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. If this verse isn't highlighted in your Bible, make that one of your applications today. Get your own Bible out, open it up, go to 2 Corinthians and start highlighting this verse. You should read it regularly. Yeah, you should hear it taught regularly. Couple of observations, four of them. Everyone is invited, whoever is in Christ. Let me tell you something about God. He has his favorites, but everybody can be his favorite. It's a whoever. Whoever is in Christ, regardless of your background, regardless of your lack of spirituality or abundance of religion or anything like that, it's about him, and he's inviting all of us to get in on what he's up to. It doesn't say whoever goes to church, whoever reads their Bible, whoever writes the biggest check for an offering, whoever prays the most. It says whoever is in Christ. So if today you've joined me on this devotional and you have yet to surrender your life to Jesus, this is where it all begins. It's getting Christ in you and you in him. And it's the best invitation you can ever accept from anyone, and that's God wanting you in his family. And even before this devotion is out, you can just say, Jesus, come into my life. I need to be in you. I love that this change is instant. That's not true of most things in our life. Otherwise, we wouldn't need lifelong memberships at a gym. We wouldn't go to a self-help section at a bookstore. All that would be irrelevant. The diet industry would completely go away if change was instant. And so most change isn't. But this is. The most significant change you'll ever experience is instant. It says whoever is, circle is in Christ. That's present tense. That's right now. Is in Christ. In other words, something that was there is gone, and something new right now is in place. You don't earn it. You don't deserve it. It's given to you by Christ. It happens right now. But if for some reason 2 Corinthians 5:17 hasn't had you just drop jawed in awe, Paul continues. Verse 18, all of this is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ. And so a holy God makes me fully acceptable to him, and he does all the work. All of this is from God. Who's it from? From God. How much of it? All of it. All of this is from God. He didn't leave any of this to our effort or our holiness. In fact, if you were to compare our nature to God's nature, we are completely incompatible. We are flash paper to fire. And if you put flash paper up against fire, fire wins 100% of the time and the flash paper is dissolved. But God did something for us we could not do for ourselves. He made us compatible. He reconciled. The word reconciled means to make compatible, to do something fundamentally, to get things in an order that they can actually be together. And so God didn't change for us to get together. We had to change. And who did the changing? God did it. All of this was from God. He makes us like himself. So in a way, we become fire, and fire is compatible with fire. And God did that. He changed our identity. This doesn't have to do with behavior. Behavior is something to come. After we are changed, our behavior starts changing. This is about our identity. This is about our position. And God did all that. He changed us. He reconciled us. But if somehow verse 17 and verse 18 doesn't just have you stunned in awe and gratitude, he adds verse 19, not counting people's sins against them, not counting your sins against you, not counting my sins against me, not counting our sins. Some of you, and this is the way I grew up, I thought that's all God was doing, was up in heaven counting my sins, being aware of the fact that I just didn't do it right again. And sometimes we live under the guilt and condemnation that this verse is telling us is no longer there. That is not what God's doing. He's completely forgiven you in Christ Jesus. What Jesus did on the cross is better than what most of us know. It's His perfect work beyond what we can even understand. And so God isn't covering up our sin as if to say it didn't matter. God paid for our sin through Christ. That's why He doesn't have to count our sins against us anymore. You know, there's some restaurants that have in their menu guilt-free sections, and somehow that food is healthier than all the other food. Well, I just want to say this verse in the Bible is a guilt-free verse, and I hope you consume it. I hope you come back to it often and you digest it and you get it in your system, because this is reminding us that this isn't us at our best. This is God at His best, completely changing us and then not having to do what we thought He would be doing, which is counting sin. He's forgiven it. But one more time, if you need one more reason to just rejoice today and something that you can carry with you the rest of your life, it's almost as if Paul left the best for last. God made Him, God made Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in Him we might become. Now, that's not in the future, but that's a we might become right now, become the righteousness of God. You are given the righteousness of God. He took all of our mess, all of our sin, all of our brokenness, all of our ugliness, and He instead put His righteousness on us, clothed in His righteousness. God doesn't begin with our behavior changing. He begins with the work He did on the cross, that He applies to our life, that He changes who we are from the inside out, making us acceptable to Him. And then because of that, we can start behaving differently. Aren't you glad? The grace of God is all about God. It's about His goodness. It's about His power. It's about His mercy. And it completely changes us. And so hope you keep coming back to this verse often. It's so powerful. So today, rather than praying in the way I normally would, which is praying for you to have something, I want to just thank God for what He has given us and ask you to join me in that. One of the greatest moments of faith is when we recognize it's been done, so gratitude is what we express, not requests. Let me lead us in that today. Jesus, thank You for how good You are, so much better than so many of us know. Heavenly Father, thank You for sending Your Son, Jesus, and then using His payment to reconcile us to You, so that our lives can be fundamentally different, changed from the inside out. And so we just want to express gratitude to You today. We want to express worship to You today. You're better than what we think. You're richer than what we're aware of. We want to just keep mining the grace and goodness of God to the best we can throughout our lifetime. We'll never reach the bottom of it, but we're going to keep consuming it. We're going to keep relying on it. We're going to keep enjoying it. So I pray that over my friends today in Jesus' name. Amen.